There we are. Hello, everybody. Monique van Dusseldorp here from Amsterdam. I'm the moderator of what I think is the most important session of the whole day, of course, because we're going to talk with some of the chief content officers in Europe. We have five people in this session. We're going to take an hour, so there's plenty of time. And you can also ask us questions, and please do, because I know there's 200-300 people in the audience. I know they are specialists in content and they know these businesses and these companies. So feel free to ask questions. They will turn up with me here in the chat that I can see. So I have a different screen than you guys, but they will turn up and I will ask them to the speakers. Now, let's start with introducing our speakers. And I said, we have four content officers and one special guest, that's Ivan Verbesselt. And I'm going to do a round of introductions and I start with Ivan Verbesselt. He's the VP Product Management with MediaGenics. Previously created IPTV business for Alcatel and was VP at Nagra Podelsky. He knows this business. But Ivan, you're also supporting this event. Thank you very much for that. Tell us, what is MediaGenics? What do they do?
MediaGenics is a partner to over 100 media groups worldwide, actually operating all along the content value chain. What we do, our mission in life is actually to optimize the content return on investment for our customers. And we do that with our flagship product called What's On. And think of it as a business management suite for media and entertainment companies to indeed optimize that content return on investment. And we do that by, actually, we increasingly perceive that it's all revolving around the supply chain challenge, which is to put the right content in front of the right audience at the right time through the right channels. And so what we do with our product is to orchestrate that digital content supply chain around increasingly a single source of truth that governs the end-to-end content workflows, right workflows, and then allows our customers to do multi-platform scheduling and to engage their audience across all those platforms.
So you have an incredibly broad view of the whole landscape of the industry because you work with all these content partners. That's what we're going to talk about in a minute. Michael Berlin, Chief Content Acquisition Officer at Allente. Tell us, Allente, that's a company that, you know, merged two separate platforms. Tell us a little bit what you are doing at the moment.
Right. So this is actually a special day. This is our 1 year birthday. So we have been in existence.
Congratulations.
Exactly 1 year. Yeah, thank you. So we are a result, as you said, from a merger of two traditional pay TV platforms called Viasat and Canal Digital, DTH based, but also with IPTV and broadband and a few other services. So this first year has been a hectic year. We launched a consumer brand just a couple of weeks ago. So it has been a lot of work going into merging these companies. Now we're out with the brand and with the services and the new packaging structure. So the first sort of hurdle is passed.
Oh, well, that must have been a tough year, you know, working hard with all these distributed teams as well. I'm going to ask this question of everybody I introduce. What is the thing you're most proud of? I guess it's just surviving this year. But yeah. content-wise, what are you? Is the thing you're most proud of with Allente?
Well, I would say it's the sort of the sum of our offering. I mean, we are an aggregator. And we don't produce our own content. So the fact that we are able to offer, not everything, but virtually everything that we wanted to our subscribers. So I would say that the sort of the aggregated sum of what we offer.
Okay, we'll talk about that more later on, what that offer is. Thomas Reitman, head of content for Blue, also just merging, you know, brands, putting a lot of different things together at Swisscom, because you don't only have an OTT platform, you also have movie theaters. That's an interesting combination. Could you tell us a little bit what you have been up to in the last year? What do you do?
Yeah, this might also just answer the question, what are we most proud of right now and
good,
the key focuses. Yeah.
Two questions, yeah. One answer, I like it.
Yeah, so Swisscom as the incumbent in the market with a substantial market share, we actually have these four pillars of entertainment and information proposition in Switzerland. And they used to be positioned under their individual brands. So as you said, it's the movie theaters, it's pay proposition, it's the Swisscom TV platform was the third one. And the fourth platform we have is Bluewin, which is an information news portal that we basically have. And what we did last year was bring these four platforms together under one brand, Blue. And so now we're actually in the process of designing the Blue 2 launch, which is then basically a further improvement of bringing these four platforms together, which are, as I said, the movie houses, the pay, the now Swisscom Blue TV platform, plus the news portal.
Yeah, very interesting combination of assets there. We'll discuss that later on. I must say that personally, I find it amazing that in this last year where everybody had to stay at home, it's no wonder a lot of TV was, you know, consumed. But the fact that, you know, even in this industry, everybody has been working so hard to also change things while working with these teams that were working from home. It's quite amazing. A lot of things have happened in the last year. You wouldn't have thought that. Thank you. Elke Waldhelm, Executive Vice President Content at Sky Deutschland. What have you been up to in the last year, and what are you proud of? I'm just going to ask both questions at the same time to introduce yourself.
Thank you. So maybe just to explain, Sky is Sky Germany is part of Sky Group that is active across the UK, Italy, and some smaller markets. So we're part of Comcast. So also, you know, NBCU is part of our big family. So overall, we're part of a very, very big group, which gives us a lot of support and comfort. What we were focusing on over the last year is, you know, creating a bigger choice for our subscribers, especially amongst the entertainment portfolio. In Germany, Sky is very famous for sports, the home of Bundesliga. And what me and my team has focused on, where we're really proud of, is expanding, especially on three things. Strengthening our movie proposition by taking opportunities, you know, that cinemas are closed. We brought a few movies ahead of or shortly after cinemas closed to our customers. So we had a cooperation with Wonder Woman, with Warner about Wonder Woman 84 and with Justice League. So that was perceived really well, and it's really strengthened also the perception of our movie offering in the market. And on entertainment, there are two things we're focusing on, we're really proud of, is we're launching more genres. So we just launched two more channel branded destinations, Sky Crime and Sky Comedy. Why I call them channel branded destinations is that it's linear and on demand, so fully available all the time. And secondly, our biggest focus is also investing more in our own productions. So Sky Originals, especially series, but also now more going into documentary, non-scripted, something where we believe is really important to make us unique in the German market with a unique content offering, which we offer via DTH, via cable, but also in a pure streaming product called Sky Ticket. So we try to bring the two worlds together. And for our residential subscribers, we also aggregate additional apps. So we just launched Disney Plus. So it's also part of our residential strategy to be a curator and an aggregator to make it very easy for the customers to find the content they love.
Yeah, it's a really big role, and there's so many parties, you know, in the landscape that want to play that role. It's an interesting competition going on. We'll come back to that later on. And then, of course, we shouldn't miss Alex Martinez. He's the content director of Movistar. Tell us, Alex, what have you been up to with Movistar? What does Movistar do, and what are you most proud of? That's a lot of questions to introduce yourself. So keep it short.
Movistar is a platform of Telefonica, and which is the number one telco in Spain. I think we do a lot of the same things that our colleagues have explained, like we are curators, we are distributors, we are creators, and also we own sports rights. In that sense, we distribute Disney Plus, Netflix, and DAZN. And but also we create our original content. We have sport channels, and we have also movies channels, which has been very difficult to maintain this year, but not as difficult at the sport channel. I think that this year we are very proud that we maintained during 3 months our sport channel news offer without any sport.
Without any sports. that's amazing. How did you do that? Just quickly.
Creativity. And also very, you know, it was very curious, because all the sports, players, appears without problem in our channel, which is not usual because they were at home also. In that sense, we create an atmosphere but very, very empathetic with the people that are in the sports business. And also during these 3 months, because I think it's a year, but also the crisis, the big crisis, what was the first 3 months, we maintain our late night programs that were done, you know, directly in the anchor home, and it was very difficult. We are very proud of that solution.
Yeah.
So that
that's what I wanted to hear. What are you proud of? You know, creativity to come up with new solutions in difficult times. That's the thing. Let's have a look at the media landscape. As I mentioned before, Ivan has a broad view because he's not in one country or with one operator but working across the whole world of operators. Ivan, we talked a little bit before about what is happening when it comes to content. I mean, we all know there's Netflix, there's Amazon, the competition is huge. Everybody tries to aggregate. Everybody tries to be, you know, the point where the consumer meets the business. But of course, these four operators that we have here have a very special role because they actually do the delivery as well. Well, how do you see the landscape right now?
Well, first of all, I think everyone has confirmed that 2020 has been a bit of a challenging year because the bigger trend is a content explosion that had to meet an ever more fragmented audience. 2020 was more a bit of a content contraction year, especially for sports. And hats off to Alex to keep your audience on sports when there is no sports. But that shows that long tail can actually work in environments like that. And when you think of it, in both cases, it's a supply chain challenge. When there's too much content to choose from, you have to decide what do I buy, what do I produce, what do I put in front of my audience. That's the supply chain challenge. When there's not enough, it's the same challenge, essentially. So you have to decide how do I use my long tail in a smart way. So that was 2020, but taking a bit of a step back, I think we're now starting to see the OTT game changer coming to fruition all across the world. And it is a game changer. If we take a bit of a step back, I think it's safe to say that it changed the level playing field and that it married two existing level playing fields. And you're all involved in those as broadband providers. One is is broadband internet access, and the other level playing field is consumer electronics. And it's brought it together because it has harmonized the whole technology stack and simplified the operations. That's the good news. The more challenging reality, of course, it has brought the entry barrier for many players. And my observation is that along the end-to-end content value and distribution chain, it has opened up the opportunity for everyone to be direct to consumer. So that's obviously the case for content owners high up in the content value chain. But it also has allowed everyone to be an aggregator along the entire content value chain. And so that, of course, has changed the landscape because typically the operator sitting on the distribution infrastructure were the quintessential natural aggregators. That has changed. Now, I would say there's still a huge opportunity for everyone along that end-to-end chain. Just if we just realize things have changed. And so maybe to throw a few pebbles into the pond here to make sure we have a discussion around it. I personally think everyone has a great opportunity in this new level playing field that OTT offers. And I think you're all playing in that environment. I think, and may challenge that, but there's three currencies of success, I would call them in OTT. There's, of course, the direct-to-consumer relation, wherever you are in the value chain. There is the data that comes from that consumer relation, because you can extract consumption data from it, but also to have a sufficiently granular view on the content itself. Like just lumping together big lumps of content packages are going to less and less cut. There is curation. I think it was Elke that mentioned curation is increasingly important. Just putting some channels together ain't going to cut it anymore. Therefore, the aggregation game is just too sophisticated right now. Now, what I'm seeing, and that's the silver lining to a cloud, which is a bit challenging at times, it's good to be in Europe. So it's good to be in this European panel here So if you look at the US, where the asphalt market is further advanced, of course, I have the impression that between pay TV and asphalt, it has become a bit of a zero-sum game. So what is being added to asphalt is detracted from pay TV. So far in Europe, we're not seeing that. And that is great news. It's been even in the...
What is the reason for that? It basically means that we spent, you know, money on pay TV and just add all kinds of subscriptions to it as well. And I mean, I can confirm my home is one where we have all the boxes and all the stuff, and I'm sure we have half the stuff double now because it's on all the networks. Why is that? Why is it so different in Europe than from the US?
My reading is history is always written afterwards, so it's very difficult to tell while you're in it. My reading is that actually, even at the immense growth that asphalt has seen, I think the compound annual growth rate is in the order of 40% over the past years, and 2020 was even more, is that all in all, the expenditure wallet of video entertainment in Europe hasn't been filled up yet. It's actually kudos to the aggregators that also offer cable or internet, that the pay TV package, apparently, and again, history is going to be written thereafter, is very good value for money. And there's still room for people to add those asphalt packages in. By the same token, that also leaves additional opportunities, and you're all starting to play in that, to bundle in. So Elke mentioned Disney Plus, Alex mentioned DAZN and the likes. You can bundle those packages in because you're the quintessential aggregator in your own region, which so you would be stupid.
So you do think that operators have a very special role when it comes to the aggregation apart, you know, because all the others try to be the aggregator as well, but because they are the delivery service as well, they have a special place there. Because we should test the rest of the panel, see if they agree with that.
You're not alone anymore, and this is obvious. Yeah.
No.
A very important role to be played.
Maybe I can chime
yeah,
in
you
here.
Chime in. There you go, Thomas.
I do see that too. You know, there's new OTT pure players. You know, the pure aggregator players without any sort of access legacy. Let's call them this, which have a very lean developmental, but also sort of a product architecture. And what we see, and I don't think we at Swisscom are the only ones that really have to improve on this one, is sort of on a product integration and subscription management level. We don't come out of a business that is really keen to see people switch subscriptions every month or every 6 months. But it's exactly what we see in the customers' needs, that they would like to experiment perhaps with more subscriptions to SWOT services. And they're actually holding back because, for example, quite a few of them are not really sure how to cancel them again.
Yeah. But in that case, Swisscom can play the role of the operator, the trusted party, make it really easy and be the intermediary, not just for the aggregation, but also for the actual subscription organization.
The actual subscription management, exactly. You know, and
is this something you do already, or is this something you intend to do?
We do already, but I think we all have to get better at it. And this takes sort of a shift also internally. How do we adjust those development processes to get our customers to a interface that allows them to easily sign up to multiple SWOT services. Yeah. And if they want to, also cancel them again, you know, and not make it difficult to actually manage subscriptions. And so for us operators that come out of a legacy business that is geared towards keeping a subscriber and the customer locked into a particular subscription model for many, many years, I think that's one thing that we need to look at very closely.
How do the others feel about that specific part of the game? You know, the subscriptions to all kinds of other packages that are in itself also aggregators. Is that a difficult relationship, or is this just something that you think you can own as operators, because you have that customer relationship? And to add to the things already mentioned before, of course the data is important and the granularity, but the design of those interactions, the design of the subscription service and the design of, say, seems to be a huge element in this, because if the user has to understand and think, this is the easiest place where I do everything, right? I mean, it's a design challenge. Who wants to respond to that one?
Look, I'm happy to share some views from the German market. So I think it's two different need states we want to address here. So the one is, you know, having just easy access via one platform in your living room on the big screen. So therefore, it's really important for us that our customers feel that we are the gateway to all the content they love to watch. So our ambition is not to tell people, please don't watch Netflix. I mean, we know that there is demand for their content, and we even have a partnership with Netflix. We bundle Netflix into our entertainment offering. So our ambition and our deep belief, and also the numbers are proving that, you know, the easier we make it for our customers to get access to all the content across different providers they love to watch. And though even we merchandise it, when you start Sky Q, you see Netflix shows, you see Amazon shows, you even see free-to-air shows. We just want our customers to feel that this is the gateway to the entertainment they love. Mm-hmm. At the same time, it's really important that we have exclusive content with Sky that is unique, that creates willingness to pay. So that also assures us on two ways that we are a relevant player. One, on the Sky View box, it's important that subscribers not just take sports and Netflix. So we have to have something that really is compelling in the competitive environment to have Sky Entertainment in addition. Doesn't need to be exclusive. But the same now applies for the OTT streaming market. Here, our ambition is also clearly that customers that do not want to subscribe for a longer period of time, that want the flexibility for a monthly subscription, that don't want to have a set-top box in their living room, they're more focused on flexible viewing via mobile devices, just to give them an easy entrance to our exclusive content, sports and entertainment. And therefore, our product Sky Ticket is really important. And that's also manufactured in a way that, you know, customers can just subscribe to it in addition to another subscription. Because also our data clearly suggests that the volume of, you know, of different subscriptions a household is willing to subscribe to is increasing. So I don't think there's just the one service people want to have. I think, you know, based on the forecast I've seen, it will probably increase from 1.4 to 2.4, so that in average in the future, people will have 2 to 3 different subscriptions, which might rotate subject to what is the content highlight on these services. But of course, our ambition as a content provider, and I think this is what we share with everybody else, is to create enough reasons to stay, just to keep the subscriber by month.
And have those reasons changed? I mean, everybody knows, you know, exclusive sports rights will work wonders, and some big Hollywood movies probably as well. And of course, what has been interesting in this whole content space is that Netflix has been very active in promoting other kinds of content that previously wouldn't be so widely shared, you know, in all kinds of languages, for instance, and then they can make something really big by just promoting it. Do you also see new kinds of content coming up, or, you know, what do you see that's new and entertaining and challenging for the content side? Something that is not sports and movies? Or is it really sports and movies? I mean, that's also the answer. I mean, maybe it is sports and movies.
I mean, maybe just to quickly add, I think we see a reinvention of non-scripted in a more premium way. So think of Tiger King's Netflix, or, you know, reinvention of cooking shows that I think are clearly different in the way they're executed on Netflix than they are in at least German free-to-air. But also Amazon has just launched in Germany Last One Laughing. It's an adaptation of an Australian show with really high-end cast, which works really well. But also among Sky, just not to forget about it. So we're also going more deeply now into documentaries and non-scripted entertainment. So I think we need to broaden the choice. I still think fiction is king. Yeah. So scripted series is still the most premium and value-attributed content we can deliver in entertainment. But I think there is a demand for more choice, for a little bit more lighthearted stuff that takes, you know, you into a different mind state. But I think the way to differentiate when you have to pay for it needs to be the quality.
Yeah.
I can maybe chime in. There is, I think we're now, if we look at the aggregation of SVOD, we all instinctively think of a convenience bundle of what are the big four or the big five, like Netflix, Prime, Disney+, Paramount+, HBO Max. We should be look beyond, and there indeed, within those bundles, they're already differentiating, like you see cooking shows coming back. There was Tiger King and all kinds of stuff. Now, I think we should look beyond them. Because with those, and I think you've given all the arguments, you have the convenience bundle that allows people to subscribe, unsubscribe, switch subscriptions off. You have a leverage onto those guys because there is the it has been growing very fast in 2020, but also churn has been rampant between those services, and that you can contain. But I think we should look beyond them. There's like 700 SVOD services worldwide. I think in Europe alone, there's in the order of 450. And they have a completely different problem. They're fighting for eyeballs. Eyeballs are driven by context, by how you put it in front of people. And there, I think as an aggregator, you can play an enormous role onto those guys. You even have much more leverage is to bundle them in an elegant way that can be easily consumed. So that's, I think, an untapped potential yet in many cases.
And it would be nice if this, you know, in this competition, a very competitive market, there's a place for a lot of new European content or other things than just sports and Hollywood, right? That would be interesting. I think we have something to protect there as well. Alex, what about Movistar? How do you see this developing over there?
Well, I agree a lot with Elke, what she has said. We are working in a different way as for example with Netflix. It's the third year that we are working with them. We are curators. We curate our content, our original content, but also the Netflix content and the Disney content. And we have created a new relation in the two ways to create value for our subscribers. In that sense, what we want, we are talking a lot in Movistar is about what to do with interface. We think the interface has to be more dynamic and has to create new ways of relation with the subscribers. In that sense, to be more, to show more, to be more proactive that we are now. No? And in that sense, the easy access, but also the possibilities, what we want to create is the idea for our subscribers that they have to stay with us to have the better entertainment and the best entertainment. And in that sense, what we are, you know, since 5 years ago, we thought that the next thing that will appear will be entertainment after the fiction years. You know that in this industry, we have. Things happen, you know, but are not that will not stay for too long in our industry. Now, in that sense, what we see is that entertainment will be big in the next.
Year. What kind of entertainment? What do you mean? Well, entertainment is a bit broad.
I think that reality.
Reality.
We in Spain, Netflix and Amazon are doing reality, are producing realities. Also the nonfiction, we have invested a lot in the last 2 years, with the same tools that we create fiction, we are creating nonfiction. So what we have learned, not only in producing, but also in creating notoriety around content as nonfiction, is something that people agree, it changed a little bit from the fiction side to the real side. No? And also we are looking for notoriety. So in that sense, for example, our late night programs where we have a daily touch with our audience and with the society are very important for us. You know, it's original content, which is not fiction, is something more the soul of the platform. It's programs. No?
Yeah, it's interesting. So you actually have your own produced late night shows that obviously compete with, you know, other late night shows, but they're yours. I mean, these are all really content considerations. You guys are all specialized in this. And I mean, Michael, for Allente, you don't produce your own content, right? You work basically on selecting in the offer. Exactly. Do you see any? Do you see the same move towards interest in reality documentary, or it's maybe early to say since you only just started there, but
I can comment on that. So I think what we're seeing in our markets is, I mean, what is still growing and what is growing quite, you know, rapidly analog is still scripted drama. And I think a lot of that is driven by sort of the move from mainly sort of importing international scripted drama to producing it locally. And we have some strong local players. And also in the SVOD space, the local players are very strong and competing, you know, head to head with the global brands. And some of our most important partners are the local SVOD players like Viaplay, TV2, C More. They're producing a lot. And also to compete with that locally, the global brands are of course also producing now local Nordic content. So we're seeing a lot of more scripted drama productions. So that is actually the growing segment, both in terms of production and viewing. And I mean, the other segments are still there, but that's the growing part.
Yeah. So, and it's so like in Spain, it's the local, you know, the local information, the local shows that are really important to the audience and might make them decide.
Yeah.
I think you all, in where you sit, you look at the content and you source it, you select it, but you also package it. And I'm just wondering, I would love to hear your views on, you know, what are new ways that, you know, make that content suddenly flies. I mean, I remember very early days with Netflix, who at the time had exactly the same content as the local operator here. But the main thing they did was that it was interface. It was, you know, if you stopped the show and you started the box again, it would continue where you had left. It was such a simple thing. And none of the operators at the time offered that little service. So there is a lot around content, which is about storing, saving, packaging, doing different things with the content that have more to do with the interface. Is this also something that you, in the role as a content director, are directly involved with, you know, how that will develop and where that will go? Who wants to answer that one first?
Well, for us at Swisscom, you know, it's part of how we integrate content. It's of course a technical feature, but it's actually very clear that if we have partnerships with SVOD providers, there used to be a time, you know, hard to believe, about 18 months ago, where access to their metadata was like a red flag, you know, don't even ask. And today this is the first subject we actually tackle and say, so what's the timeline to get our metadata integrated into your search feed?
Yeah.
So these things have definitely evolved, and also the exposure of key assets in content lanes have become kind of a standard way to integrate. What we're looking at is now to actually have these integration points, and how do we create an upsell path through this? You know, how do we get people interested in sort of subscription content? People who haven't been used to actually paying for a subscription, that they are willing to go down that path, maybe get a free preview, and then because they're convinced this was a great experience, are willing to actually subscribe to one of the services.
And what is so special that they want to subscribe? I mean, what makes the difference?
Well, you know, Switzerland historically has not been a country that was very open to paid services. So there is still a remnant of this where people are just critical to even explore something that they might have to pay for on top of what they're paying for the TV access. And so for us, it's really to lower that hurdle for them to enter that space, and then also make it kind of fun to subscribe. And as I just said, and also have sort of the certainty that with us as a partner, they can get out of the subscription if they don't want to stay in it.
Okay, that's just the ease of the interface and how you organize it. And is there also, I mean, it's interesting that, and I don't want to keep referring to Netflix, but of course they now have a shuffle feature that they're playing with, and it basically serves up a linear channel based on your own preferences. So it's in between on demand and linear. I mean, it's a new genre that's coming up now that we have all the data, you can do that. Is this also something you explore? I mean, are there different ways of serving up content to your base than there were before because of the technology? It is a very, you know, it's a future-oriented question. Michael.
Yeah. So to comment on that, I mean, we are not developing that ourselves at the moment. Comment on what Thomas said, so we recognize a lot of that. So moving from wanting to ingesting content on our own platform and playing it out to, you know, looking at metadata integration to enhance search instead from our platform. But I think tied to what you were asking now, Monique. So, I mean, let's not forget the linear channels. I think we have quite a traditional target group, and the linear, it's maybe not the most sexy thing to talk about, but that is still sort of the core of our business and what our subscribers watch the most. And there we have, you know, a perfectly well-functioning interface with the EPG grid. It still works. That's how they, you know, most of our customers want to find the content, and they know how to find it. So that's working perfectly well. And I think that the development that you are describing, so sort of emulating that linear feeling in a streaming service, it sort of points to the linear world's strengths. That is, it serves a purpose to have a continuous stream of content. That's also a way to discover. That's also content discovery.
Have
it stream.
And by the same token, if I may add to it, so I totally agree. Linear is not dead by any standard. Even Netflix is starting to put linear there. Linear is a way of content discovery. It's like what was there and what is going to be there. By the same token, so the quote unquote channels or quote unquote broadcasters, and I'm starting to have an increasing problem calling them broadcasters because they're not actually broadcasters anymore. They've actually been taken, and I see there was a question in the chat here.
Oh, there is, yes.
Yeah. I've opened the chat in the meantime. I've chiming in on that one. I think we must admit that they are very prominently grabbing the opportunity of being an aggregator themselves and being a direct-to-consumer property. So yes, they're part of the EPG, but they're not locked into the EPG. And coming to the question on the panel there, it's actually, the credit must be given to broadcasters because they've been forging alliances in their local market to create the likes of Salto, Join Plus, Streams, BritBox, Videoland, Viaplay, TV2 Play.
You know them all.
I can go on for a while. And it's in every single market. They've been forging those alliances and becoming digital properties in their own right. So I'm actually asking because in some countries, the cable operators have invested in it. I think it's like in Belgium, the case for Streams. I'm asking myself whether that wouldn't be an additional endeavor for the infrastructure centric aggregators. I would call them like yourself to also invest in those kind of initiatives.
Yeah. The local heroes, so to speak. We actually have three questions here, but let's see if Elke or Alex want to respond to this, you know, this idea.
Well, the local point is very important, and I think it's an advantage we have over the global because we know very well the relation we have with the consumers, and we know them. And also we know what they want to see and what they are watching. And in that sense, I agree that the linear channels are not dead at all. It's another form of consumption, and they are working well, but also they are working different than they worked in the past. In that sense, we have to learn also how to use them. For me, there is a big problem and very important problem in this panel is showing us where we are. We are talking a lot about global competitors or global brands. We are in Europe, we are in small countries, and we are fighting with our, you know, in a situation with which is very difficult to fight or to compete, no? And in that sense, I think that we have to do something, I don't know what, but we have to do something to be stronger than we are now. I think that I told you in the preparation of this panel is that the European sovereignty in the audiovisual side is in danger. And I think that in the next years, we will see that local shows will be decided in in Los Angeles. It's
And that's, I mean, the discussion of the you know, endangered content industry in Europe has been going on for 25 years. It's not new. And I have the idea that European content is thriving, that it's, you know, so much being produced and so much is being made. And the audience also has become bigger.
Yes, am I too optimistic? We have to learn to work together.
And
in that sense, it's to create shows that have the, you know, this more strong economy, you know, investment, and maybe can work in Germany and for Sky Deutschland and for Movistar or for Swisscom. We have to change the rules, because if not in very few years, it will be very difficult to maintain our operations.
Elke, what about, we touch on different topics, and I have two more really interesting questions here, and I wanted to also touch on something else in the end. Elke, what is your view here?
Yeah, I mean, we touched now on so many different
points. Yeah, we're going all over the place. Sorry about that. Pick up the thing you want to add there.
Yeah, maybe let me pick up the relevance of aggregation again. And also, I think it was Michael mentioning the role of metadata. So for us, it's really important to make it easy to find content. I think making content easy to discover and searchable is one of the key differentiator that we need to land. So for example, we just improved our voice search, where you can just, you know, ask your remote control what to watch or what have I missed, so that there's a very more intuitive way of presenting the content to the customer. Also, we improved a lot and we're still doing our user interface in SkyQ and doing a lot of A/B testing, doing a lot more with the recommendation engines and trying to fine tune more about, you know, recommendation, personalization, and bringing new content to subscribers' attention, so that they're not just going back to the stuff they already know. And I think that's probably a challenge for all of us with all that broad choice of content customers have.
Though I do think there's a really special and super relevant part of content that's rewatching. I mean, rewatching is, you know, my kid just watched the third run of all Friends episodes. I mean, can you imagine? I mean, rewatching is such a big part of people's life. They find it reassuring.
No, I totally agree. I think it's both. When we look at least at the research we are conducting, the value attribution and the willingness to pay is more likely to be linked to first run, something new, most recent stuff. But when we look at total consumption and time spent, of course, the classics, you know, the movies you want to see over and over again. So whenever there is Top Gun or Pretty Woman, I don't know if this is a pan-European phenomenon, but you always have great, great ratings. And also still, you know, 2.5 Men, How I Met Your Mother, Friends. I mean, these are the things that people just enjoy watching again because they have some sort of a cult status. But I would say it's just a handful of things that have that status, and people just want to re-engage over and over again. Mm-hmm. But having said that, one of our you know, strategies also, how can we, with all the stuff that we're launching, it's sometimes hard to give everything the attention it deserves. So what we're working on is also, how can we resurface content that have already been launched last summer, like an original Gangs of London from the UK, which we launched last year, which we still think isn't utilized and discovered in a way that we think it fits to the local audience. So we're gonna put it back into a campaign in the summer, just to surface single shows, but also to strengthen the overall perception that there is a great set of originals available on Sky and not just the one new show we wanna promote.
Okay, we only have 15 minutes left, and I have some questions from the audience. I'm going to ask them, and whoever has an answer to that question, let me know. So first of all, is 4K content part of the strategy? Four people involved here. 4K, yes, no, very important, not so important. 8K is what we're going for. Really short answers, please. Who wants to say yes or no?
Yes.
Yes.
That's another yes.
The debate is more HDR versus SDR. So we just launched HDR.
HDR. And the others? HDR versus SDR? No?
Yes.
Not yet. You're first putting legacy systems together, right? You know, that's a big challenge. Okay. Alex, if you want to...
Yes. For us, it's important. It's a strategy that we're investing in.
Okay, good. Yeah. And Movistar? And Swisscom, Thomas?
Well, it depends if we're talking about ingest and production or if we're looking at aggregating 4K channels. If I look at 4K TV channels, I think the novelty out of that phenomenon is gone. It's become commodity. People expect it. The problem is the advertisers are not willing to pay more to have their advertising being aired in 4K, which then of course puts the burden on the broadcasters how to refinance these new signals, which are now in 4K. I think in summary, it's a commodity. You have to have it. We don't expect any additional topspin by promoting 4K as 4K. That those times are gone.
Clear answer. Another question about something new. It's all about non-interactive viewing, somebody says. Does the panel have any thoughts on how new entertainment types like gaming and two-way entertainment could strengthen the operator's position? Is anybody from the four of you involved in this?
Very much so. Swisscom, we started, I think it's a broader discussion actually. It starts kind of how do we position TV, how do we position entertainment proposition within the gaming context. What we see is from experience, if we put gaming too close to the sort of original understanding of TV entertainment, we don't have synergies there really. Where we have synergies, partially obviously, is if we put it next to access, broadband, speed, that combination works. But the combination of gaming, esports with television, that is sort of a perceived synergy that I think comes from more from our heads than from the gaming.
And what about all those channels that on Twitch, for instance, that are basically TV channels where people watch other people game? Is that something that is part of the offer?
Yeah, Twitch. I mean, Twitch is one of our top 10 apps on big screen, so no interaction possible. People like to see what goes on in the chats, so that has established itself to be definitely a value add. And we don't see that actually people are screaming for the possibility to interact over voice or remote. They do it over a second screen.
Yeah. I tend to agree. This, the notion of interactive TV, I think we've been talking about that now for 30 years.
Yes, my whole working life. Yes,
go ahead. Exactly. So I'm giving away my age, but to me, feels a bit like a bad good idea, to be honest. It's like t-commerce, been talking about that forever, it never actually took off, so it's maybe time to just retire the idea and move on.
Does anybody else has a views on gaming or interactive types of entertainment from the point of view of the operator, other than selling the fastest access so that people want to go there?
Maybe a short answer, it's not a priority for us, so we're really focusing on video entertainment. We looked at it several times, but it's not an easy one to crack. as the target groups are already seem to be very well served into in as part of their communities via YouTube or other ones that are more specific. We also looked a lot into esports. I think that could have been something with a most broad appeal, but still it's really hard to find a business model around it and to address a mainstream audience with it. So
yeah,
maybe we should bury it. Maybe we will regret it. I don't know. I think it's one of the question marks still to crack.
Okay. Well, we only have 10 minutes left. Yes, go ahead.
Yeah, I just agree that it's not a priority for us. And as you say, it's, those needs are served elsewhere, probably better than we could with our platforms. So it's not something we're looking into at the moment.
Okay. Well, we have only 10 minutes left. And there's one more question. Basically, the question is, we touched upon it already, you know, the biggest challenges for the video on demand business during the last year. Well, lack of sports content was maybe one, but I'd like to take it one step further and give you all the chance to say, what is it that you will want to have accomplished in 5 years that is new? I mean, that doesn't already exist, and that's not more clients and better programs and so forth, but are there new things you are exploring and investigating and working on that you feel will result in something new over the next few years when it comes to how we consume content, what content we have, what you know, how we interact with it, where you are active, just the new stuff, you know, just give us your business plan for the next 5 years. Who wants to go first?
I can
because
start
it's a big market.
Yeah, I can start if you want.
Yeah.
So fast forwarding 5 years, I think if we're really serious about smartly organizing the content supply chain, everything has to become much more data driven. And we're all talking about it right now, but we really need to make that next step of smart packaging and data driven curation. And we're if really looking at how the European market is going to position itself against the big international and fundamental digital players, then you can't bring a knife to a gunfight, and we have to fight with the same means. So that is something we as an industry need to establish, which is a smarter, more data-driven way of curating content and putting indeed the right content at the right time in front of the right audience.
And do you think that what will others do in the next 5 years? Do you think there will be a big role for regulation, for instance? That's certainly something that in Europe.
Sure. There was actually a smart comment by Alex who said, well, his concern is genuine, I think, yeah, that the European landscape may be dwarfed a bit by the national landscape. And that's a person who speaks Spanish who's saying that, right? Let's get that straight.
Yeah, you're big market.
we share the same mother tongue. There's less than 25 million people speaking it. So this is something we should be somewhat concerned about. Regulation is coming to the table. As usual, regulators are late to the party, but it's going to be beyond quota, because quota-wise, it starts at the UK. I looked it up for the SVOD offers in Europe. That includes those 400 other also offers as well. We're currently at 20% of local content. It's not too bad. It's beyond quota. It's about discoverability. Because if you're going to put content curated and in a data-driven way curated in front of people, then it's about the prominence, the prioritization, the discoverability of content. And that's part and parcel of your user interface. So it's not just quota. It's what you put in front of people's eyeballs and how do they find it. And so you're fighting the culture game, I think, at multiple levels, not just at the availability of content, but the discoverability thereof as well.
Yeah, great. And just to add one question, because I don't want to miss it, because it's a very relevant question. When we talk about the future and where we could go, one question is, when it comes to interactive viewing of recommendations, are any of the operators experimenting with recommendations on your platform influenced by friends and family or watch together? But that's another layer you can add to content that might make content more interesting or fun. Who wants to go? Elke, maybe you want to pick this up? And we have 6 minutes, so you have to answer in 1 minute and a half.
Okay, let me try. So I think the two key things in 5 years' time we all need to crack is content discovery and recommendation. And I think the examples you just made are good ones. We're not there yet, but we're looking at it. But the second thing is also how to create more talkability about relevant content to get to stand out in the mass of the offerings and create more engagement with certain contents. And personally, I don't think we will have a lot more of the big Game of Thrones or the mass market appeals where everybody will talk about. I think it will go more into communities and bubbles and different segments. And I think that's the big challenge for us to get into the relevant segments and engage with those target groups we really want to keep as our customers and create more talkability also amongst social and create interaction there.
Ah, interesting. Yeah. So the granularity of the knowledge you have about your customers and your content will also create new kinds of content specifically for those groups. Yeah, great. Alex.
I agree with Elke again. I think it's the conversation, being the conversation is the key point. And to create things or create content that also are relevant and create engagement. And that I think that we will have to create less content, but bigger than what we are doing now. To create that sensation, and also I will tell you from Spain that there are good news in the global market is that we have a language that travels very well.
Yes,
we are jealous. We are creating content for the first time for community of 300 million people. So. And it works in Latin America with the subtitles. It's curious because the problem of the language of the different Spanish way of talking, it has been solved by the subtitles in this travel. And also, I think that in that sense, it's good news for the Spanish market. But also, I think that we have a problem with the regulation, and it's very slow. And the game is very difficult to maintain with this situation in Europe. And I think that the sense that we have good news there, we need to
Thank you. And Thomas?
Yeah, it's the three key words, as an operator, aggregator. We want engagement, relevance, and I think it's the, adding smartness, intelligence to subscription management. Those are the three key points we need to focus
on. Very clear answer. Thank you. And Michael?
Yeah, so considering our position and our strategy, I think we don't want to be part of a revolution. We want to be part of an evolution and to increasingly combine linear with on-demand content. We think it's better together to have that combination and to move our sort of existing model of bundling content from the linear world to the on-demand world, but in a gradual way. That's what we'll be doing in the next 5 years.
Oh, well, very concise answer. Thank you very much. It's time to wrap up this session. Thank you all so much for your contributions. There's another, there's lots of content sessions today. There's another one that I moderate this afternoon as well. So join me if you want to. And thank you again. Thank you, everybody.
Pleasure. Bye, everyone.
Pleasure. Bye-bye.